chapter, I've been walking along the Rio Grande, which we all know is the natural border between Mexico. Well, natural is in water, but highly unnatural is in giving a water responsibility to divide two nations that were once one nation, Rio Grande. And I'm walking with Susan Armitage Page. She's a friend of mine from North Carolina, an artist. And for 10 years, she has been taking this walk, and she collects the objects that people leave behind as they make the crossing from one nation into the next. People drop many objects, and she collects them. She first photographs them in situ, and she puts them into a bag and lays them with Liver and Guadalupe, because of course. And then she takes them back to her studio in North Carolina and photographs them again and hangs them side by side. It's very moving to see these images. I'll actually show them to you in just a moment. So that is what's happening when I get to this part. Hidalgo stretches along the banks of the Rio Grande. Its walls are the ugliest I have seen. Miles of concrete slabs, teethed in tall steel posts that preside over the green, like a cubist sentry. We find the hiking trail leading to the wall, but what should be a 5-minute walk takes us nearly 30. The trail is practically paved with objects. Here's one, Susan says, stopping this stride and reaching for her camera. I peek over her shoulder to find a toothbrush at her feet, whole and blue. A red one, missing its bristles, lies a few inches away, along with a broken hair clip. This is what the border used to look like. At Brownsville, it means it's really active. She slides the objects into a bedroom. Next is a purple shirt tangled in weeds. As she grabs one end and pulls, a Border Patrol vehicle drives by. Its back end is outfitted with a holding cell, something a dog catcher might use. Before I can mention it, Susan says, "Well, look at that," and bounds over to a Macy's bag, half hidden in a clump of grass. A pair of Wrangler originals tumbles out, then a long sleeve shirt, and finally a handsome belt with a buckle shaped like a longhorn. She examines jeans. Size 32 by 30, made in China, still wet. It's probably weather here, she speculates. Over the years, she's learned the Border Patrol does not allow immigrants to bring anything wet aboard their vehicles, because there's no way to drive close to the station. Belts are also not permitted, lest they be used as weapons. Same with shoelaces, same with hairbrushes, same with toothbrushes. Bras are often a sign of rape, she says. Coyotes will hang them on a tree afterward, like a trophy. Home flotation devices usually mean a baby has been brought across. Sometimes you find religious cards on the banks of the river and know someone left them there, and thanks for a safe passage. You see caffeine pills so they can stay awake during the journey. We continue down the trail, toothbrush, toothbrush, shoelace, shoelace, a water bottle squished, a tennis shoe, half of a comb, most of a shirt, nail clippers, another shirt, a lacy black bra. Susan and I halt mid-step. A lacy black bra. It's not hanging from a tree, but still, it's a lacy black bra. When this expedition began at Hope Park a few days ago, it felt like a most peculiar egg hunt. But as the Liberian began to fill, I started to see as Susan does, the objects as reliquaries, the journey as pilgrimage. That the vulnerability of this bra curled in the dirt renders the trail into a crime scene. No woman abandons her lacy black bra unless forced to, unless she has surrendered the entirety of her attention. Scattered nearby are two pairs of panties, a wallet, a travel-sized speed stick, a pocket-sized Bible, the Guadalupe Testamento, two pairs of socks rolled into balls, 3-ounce tube of Colgate, a packet of Trident chewing gum, 5 packages of pills in various colors and sizes, and a light blue handkerchief. The relief I feel from this additional discovery. Maybe Border Patrol agent made her drop everything, as opposed to a coyote ripping off that one thing. Gives way to the dread of imagining a woman walking around without these items. Nothing here is irreplaceable, but the woman who packed these items did so with care. Her bra looks almost new, her panties are still folded. So often in our culture, we are the sum of our possessions. Indeed, at times they seem the only markers of our passage through this world. What does it mean to pare them down to the essentials, and then to lose even those? A siren goes off. Commotion ensues in the near distance. We quicken our pace as a Border Patrol vehicle pulls up from behind. A Tejano agent sticks out his head and informs us 60 bodies have been found up ahead. Bodies? I ask, envisioning the pile of corpses. We got two of them, rescued back to Mexico. Where are you ladies headed? Susan tells her story and asks them and walk down by the river. Si, pero. He looks at me. Pero peligroso? I ask. It's dangerous. Pues sí. He rolls up the window. Sure is. We hurry on until we see three Border Patrol vehicles idling by the wall. One is outfitted with a container cell I noticed earlier. A female agent steps out, walks around back, and opens the door of the cell. Susan and I freeze in place as a middle-aged woman pops out. Maybe 5 feet tall with sienna skin and curly hair, she's dressed more for a day at the office. Nice slacks, a jacket, pumps, then performing an international riverbed. Susan puts her camera down as the woman climbs aboard the adjacent vehicle. Although the windows are darkly tinted, I see her head turn sharply away from us. Next out is a 40-ish man with an Olmec nose wearing a white shirt and jeans. He pauses to look at Susan and me before stepping inside the awaiting vehicle. My hand instinctively rises and waves. What I mean by this is hard to articulate, but something like, you are here and I am here, the way our ancestors have always been here, but now you're being taken away from here. Well, I still get to stand here, and I am bearing witness to the injustice of that, and I am so sorry. I watch the man get swallowed inside the dark of the windows and search for a place to rest his gaze. At one point, he seems to be looking at me. For half a second, I wonder whether or not to wave again. He beats me too.